Thank you, everybody, for joining with us today. Obviously, we're here to talk about the border. I want to thank everybody who is up here with me today. We've got the chair of the House Appropriations Committee, Greg Vine. We have the Speaker of the House, Dave Kuhn, and the Lieutenant Governor, Dan Patrick, and the Chair of Senate Finance, Jay Nelson, as well as members of both the Texas House and Senate, together with us for this announcement. Let me start by saying this, and that is the problem. People are suffering on the border. Just continue to get worse. And getting worse for the residents who live in that region. They're getting worse for people in all regions across the entire state of Texas. If you just look at the numbers, they paint the picture. Look at the number of people who were apprehended coming across the border last April when President Trump was president. They apprehended just over 17,000 people coming across the border last year. This year, in the month of April, they apprehended more than 170,000 people. That is a 1,000% increase in the number of people apprehended coming across the border year over year. Similar numbers were echoed in the month of May. Also, the type of people coming across the border is changing. Early on, it was unaccompanied minors. Now, a majority of the people coming across the border are adults coming across alone. Also, what is changing is the carnage is being caused by the people who are coming across the border. Fences of ranchers along the border are being completely decimated, causing border ranchers to lose their livestock or border farmers to lose their crops. Homes are being invaded. Neighborhoods are dangerous, and people are being threatened on a daily basis with guns. The people either coming across the border or those working with those who are coming across the border. Cartels, human and drug smugglers, and human traffickers, they're all profiting off of our open border crisis. They're making money off the people that have come in from more than 150 different countries across the entire globe. Anybody who tells you this is people coming across Mexico or from the Northern Triangle, they're missing the point about the massive consequence of all the countries across all the entire globe that people are coming from, and they will either fly in or somehow get into Mexico or get into South America and make their way up to come across the border into Texas and into other states.
And make no mistake,
the border crisis that we're dealing with right now is a direct result of the open border policies that had been put into place by the Biden administration. Remember that the border was far more under control under the Trump administration until President Biden came in and removed the Remain in Mexico policy. And he's about to remove, according to his administration, the Title 42 policy. And obviously they are now not making any effort whatsoever to construct the wall. In fact, they are abandoning finishing the wall along the border. But the biggest difference between the but it's clear that this Operation Lone Star, as prolific as the results have been, it's clear that more is needed. And the people who made that clear are the counties on the border. Because what the counties on the border did, they sent me a disaster declaration that the counties made, requesting that the governor of Texas make a disaster declaration for the counties on the border. Now, the governor makes disaster declarations when we have hurricanes come in. Sometimes some tornadoes occur. Sometimes some floods may occur. I am unaware of a governor ever declaring a disaster at county requests because of the tidal wave of illegal immigrants coming across the border, wrecking havoc in communities and residents who live here in Texas. And since I went down to Del Rio last week, what I talked to sheriffs and county judges at that time about was to issue a second disaster declaration, for which there are more than two dozen counties who already want to be a part of it, even though the new disaster declaration has not even been issued yet. But it's going to concentrate on making arrests on the border of people who are coming across. So the Department of Public Safety will work with local officials to arrest anybody who enters our state illegally for violations such as trespass, for vandalism, for criminal mischief, for smuggling. Speaking of which, the people that you're looking up here right now, the members of the Texas House and Texas Senate, they passed a new smuggling law that makes it easier for prosecutors to be able to prosecute smuggling in the state of Texas, and I applaud them for passing that. And the prosecutors in the region were urging and begging for it so that they would be able to prosecute these smugglers. And you will see that there is going to be a lot more people put into jail. People who are crossing the border illegally and trespassing, or people who are engaging in the smuggling process or drug smuggling process, or even these crimes that are occurring anywhere. But we want to make sure they have the tools and the resources they need to be able to put those people in jail. But that does mean that more jail space will be needed. And to help accommodate that, the Texas Commission on Jail Standards is working with counties to be able to expand jail space, to enhance. But before I go there, let me say this. I want to applaud and thank fellow states across America. When I was in Del Rio, I had an announcement that night about how myself, as well as the Arizona Governor Doug Ducey, we entered into a multi-state compact, or we triggered a multi-state compact that responds to emergencies and disasters. And we asked governors of other states to join in with us to help address the disaster that we're facing. And there have been a number of states that have already offered support or are working with their office about support, and they include our neighbors of Oklahoma and Arkansas, which stretches up to North Dakota and South Dakota. It includes Iowa and Florida, and already Georgia and South Carolina have sent their National Guard to the Texas border. We appreciate all of them, as well as others that I may be unaware of yet, because this is happening as we speak right now. But for every state stepping up, just know that the people of the state of Texas, your fellow Americans, appreciate you stepping up. But I'll add this. For all the states that are stepping up to help Texas, you're helping your own residents and nothing else, but helping to prevent or reduce the amount of fentanyl that is coming into the United States. Let me give you some quick numbers that are very important. In just the first 4 months of this year, just the Texas Department of Public Safety had an 800% increase in the amount of fentanyl that they had apprehended coming across the border. In just the first 4 months of this year, just the Texas Department of Public Safety, they apprehended enough fentanyl to kill more than 21 million Americans. And that fentanyl goes to states across the entire country. Every state helping out Texas. You're helping your own citizens and residents in your state from dealing with this deadly drug coming to neighborhoods near you.
Well, the ability for us to
be able to arrest people coming across the border is going to be enhanced by Texas building border barriers. Some of those barriers are These immediate barriers are truly just a stopgap effort to slow the incredible inflow of migrants into Texas. But they do create what are considered to be no trespass zones that can lead to arrest trespassers. When there's a barrier up, it will have on it do not trespass signs. Anybody who comes through or around or near that barrier is subject to being arrested for aggravated trespass, and because these counties are subject to a disaster declaration, the penalties for a trespass have been enhanced so that they are, at a minimum, a Class B misdemeanor or potentially a Class A misdemeanor, which means they could spend a long time behind jail for violating the trespass laws of Texas. But listen, we know that temporary barriers and fences won't be enough to slow the flow of the record amount of illegal immigration that's taking place. That's why today we are announcing that Texas will build a border wall in our state to help secure our border. Here's how the process is going to begin and how it will be structured. We start by hiring a program manager. This is going to be a large-scale construction project that needs a program manager to oversee it. The program manager, in turn, will hire contractors and subcontractors to complete the project. I can add this, and that is to speed the process as well as to lower the cost of the project. The project manager can look to land that's already owned either by the state of Texas or owned by the local governments or owned by private citizens who want to volunteer that land for locations where a border wall can be placed. My belief, based upon conversations that I've already had, is that the combination of state land as well as volunteer land will yield hundreds of miles to build a border wall in Texas. The program manager and the contractors, once they get to work, they will be able to provide us with a more accurate estimate of what the cost will look like going forward. To get all of this going, we need to hire the program manager. And that process begins right now. I am signing a letter that is from me directed to the executive director of the Texas Facilities Commission. It says, in just a couple of sentences of it, it says, as the state agency in charge of procuring, building, and managing state-owned property, your work is central to building projects in our state. I hereby direct the Texas Facilities Commission to hire a program manager to oversee construction of a Texas border wall. A program manager will lead the process of planning and scoping the project and hiring the contractors and subcontractors needed to build the wall.
Next
is funding. A letter that we are about to sign provides $250 million to be allocated as a down payment to begin the border wall. That's a $250 million, and it's more than enough to hire the project manager and the contractors and to begin building the wall. And we are committed to adding more resources as needed going forward. Start.
this program
is officially funded in the state of Texas. Today, I am also sending a letter to President Biden. His administration is refusing to finish the border wall on land that the federal government took from our fellow Texans. I am demanding that the Biden administration immediately return to Texans land that the federal government took to build the wall. Texas will talk to those property owners about Texas using that land to build the wall.
President Biden.
Thank you for your leadership. left got to the point. President Trump was getting the border under control. Had we had four more years with him, we would be in total control of the border. But all of the protocols he set in place, the wall that he was building that now President Biden is on the front of, are simply President Biden has made the choice that he's letting the drug cartel take control of this country instead of the rule of law. Texas will get this done. We will get this done. We have no choice to get it done. We will not let our state, our country be invaded. We will not let it happen. Governor, thank you. Thank you.
Now, Speaker, thank you.
Governor, I want to thank you as well for the ingenuity and the time you have made the Texas solution and the Washington Department. That's what it comes from. This is a legal crisis, security crisis, it's a humanitarian crisis. These are children. Families being smuggled across the border.
Drug cartels bringing weapons
to the streets, not just in Texas. And I speak for the vast majority of Texas. They're not getting. A letter was sent out today. Come down and hear this. So the Texas House will hear this.
I hear the special session coming soon. Don't know when. But we're going to start having this hearing. I want to thank the governor again for his leadership, ingenuity,
and the fact that he is part of.
I'll close with this and then take a few questions. To the people who live in border regions, you've been begging for help. You've been demanding a response. You've pled with urgency to be protected, to be supported, to be heard, to have a response. Working with various different agencies. It could be with the Texas Jail Commission, it could be with local officials, or it could be with the Texas Department of Public Safety.
Governor,
where's the money coming from? Is it coming from the budget?
Kevin or Abbott.
Beginning in 2015, under my administration, and the other office holders at that time, Texas began to step up and allocate money to secure the border. That strategy was lessened to some extent over the past 4 years when we had President Trump in office who did more than anybody's ever done, including adding personnel, working in collaboration. As a result of President Trump's efforts, it led to a dramatic decrease in the amount of people coming across the border. As I pointed out in my remarks earlier, the second full month of the Biden administration, which was in the month of March, in response to the Biden administration's lack of concern, we launched Operation continue adding more turning them over to federal officials who would then release them. And that's just not going to work.
And that's where we had to begin to come up with new strategies that would be effective,
which includes this immediate fencing, which includes the border wall, which includes anyone who thinks this is politics doesn't care about American citizens, Texas residents. Anyone who thinks this is politics doesn't care about the lives of people who have done stuff to their dad by someone who came across the border. Doesn't care about their kids who have been harmed. Doesn't care about the homes that have been invaded. Doesn't care about the danger these people live with every single day. It's our job to keep these people safe, not allow them to continue to be subject to harm. providing safety
for our fellow citizens. I realize men and leaders are some who do not care about safety. Those are the very same people who want to defund police. And we
together also passed
a law to make sure that cities in Texas would not be able to defund police. We believe in the rule of law and law and order in this state. And by God, we're going to step up and deliver that rule of law and law and order.
Sent out by anybody who lives in
Texas knows that water conservation notices
are sent out every summer.
Because of
summer heat, you should not be using your water sprinkler during
the time of day because it's not efficient. All ERCOT was doing was saying that because repairs were being made to power generators that amounted to 9,000 megawatts of power, there was going to be less power available than there had been. And that meant to
engage in a level of conservation. What that means, what that meant is for 4 hours in
high demand, which was from 3
p.m. to 7 p.m., if possible,
you should try to reduce your usage
of power during that time.
During the other 20 hours of the day, it didn't matter. And then the corollary of that is that
even though
by
law, seen basically zero implementation, but we did see one component of it implemented. One demand made by
the legislature, but also demand made by the public, was
greater communication by ERCOT
to let people know what was going on. This was an example of that greater communication to let people know what was going on. Not that there was a power emergency. If you go into the ERCOT
database, you go to their website, you go to their app, which I use
you'll see there are different
energy emergency alerts. And that is when power is really, we didn't enter into an energy emergency alert. It was just a conserve power.
So then we'll make it through a
couple of days that we needed as those repairs were made, which we have made it through those couple of days now. And candidly coming out to those 9,000 megawatts
of power generators that were being
repaired, they got the repairs done
now before the real of summer tests.
And they should be prepared to go through the summer fully capable
of meeting demands. Bottom line is, as we've said before, if you look at all the laws, not just
SB 2 and 3, they're both SBs. I couldn't remember what was next week. But if you look at the bills we signed, but not just those, there's a lot of bills they signed
concerning the energy grid
in Texas. And I can tell you for a fact
that as we're sitting here today,
the energy grid in Texas is better today than it's ever been. Engineers and architects
and the contractors to give us the answers to. That's why we had to kick off this process to trigger the hiring of the program managers. So the program managers can hire the contractors, and it will be that team that then will, among other things, go talk to all these property owners and find out where they can move the wall. And the cost of it will depend on the location where it is,
what materials exist, what the material cost is at that particular time, and what the design will be. Decisions about which
components of the wall of a person's
vehicle.
to determine what the cost is before a fuller. Step up and address their humanitarian crisis and debt.